In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. Today is Tuesday, July the 14th. We look at the beautiful Psalm 29, Psalm of David, which is basically entitled "The Praise to God in His Holiness and Majesty." Praising God for the beauty of His holiness, for the awesomeness of His majesty. Psalm begins with, "Give unto the Lord, O you mighty ones. Give unto the Lord glory and strength. Give unto the Lord the glory due His name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness." This is a reminder of what the church is meant to be, what the body of Christ was called to do together, is in one body, one heart, and one spirit, to give unto the Lord, to ascribe unto Him true glory and strength, the glory that is worthy of His name. This His name is worthy of glory. Not that He needs our glory to be glorified, because He is the King of glory. He is in essence glorified at all times. But it is for our eternal joy and benefit. Our fulfillment is to glorify God in the beauty of His holiness, as it says, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Holiness is a beautiful thing. Holiness is majestic. Holiness is something that once a person tastes it, will want to live in it and worship God in it and through it all the days of their lives. That's why King David will say in a later psalm, "Taste and see that the Lord is good." And then it goes on to say, "The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord is over many waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty." Now we can see many spiritual reminders here. The voice of the Lord is over the waters, as in creation, the book of Genesis. The God of glory thunders. His voice thunders. We hear His voice, the majesty of God's voice, over many waters, just as the Lord in baptism, the voice of the Father was heard saying, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." Many times it is written, or there's witness to the Lord, the voice of the Lord thundering through. When the Lord Jesus said, "Father, glorify your name," and the people thought it thundered, when the Lord said, "I have both glorified it and will glorify it again." So this is a powerful reminder of the voice of the Lord, that while it can speak to us in a still small voice in our hearts, it is powerful and majestic, full of majesty. We see also in the continuation, the voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. Of course, cedars are meant to be something huge and large, but the voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. The fathers refer to the cedars here as being idols, that idols will totter at the presence of God, as it says in Isaiah chapter 19, that the voice of the Lord will break the cedars, will break the idols, will break anything that is not worthy of God. As the Lord splinters the cedars of Lebanon, He makes them also skip like a calf, Lebanon and Syrian like a young wild ox. Now, again, the meaning of how the idols will totter at the presence of the Lord, that people will come and worship the true God in the joy and the meaning of what that holds. It says in verse 7, "The voice of the Lord divides the flames of fire." Then it says in verse 8, "The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness." The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh. Now, this point about the Lord's voice dividing the flames of fire, this is a very powerful verse. And many people have experienced the power of praising the Lord from this psalm, saying, "The voice of the Lord divides the flames of fire." The voice of the Lord divides, if the flames of fire represent evil, He divides evil. The voice of the Lord discerns between the thoughts and intents of the heart, as it says about the Word of God in St. Paul's letter to the Hebrews in chapter 4. The voice of the Lord divides anything that is basically dividing the soul from Him. The Lord, if we allow His voice to be heard and work in us, He can help us rightly divide His Word and also rightly divide the things that are not meant to be in us, that are not of His nature, that are alien to His purity. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The fathers speak of the wilderness as the souls that are under attack by different human passions and temptations and lusts, that the voice of the Lord can shake all this. It can break the shackles and bondages of addiction and sin. That's the power of the voice of the Lord. When the Lord speaks, the earth listens, and the Lord will always be waiting for His children to say, "Speak, Lord, for your servant hears." We ought to truly say that from our heart, "Lord, speak, for your servant hears." The Lord is willing to shake adversity and shake all the things that are hindering us and sapping us of our joy and our peace by replacing it with His peace that surpasses all understanding. The voice of the Lord makes the deer give birth and strips the forest bare, and in His temple everyone says, "Glory." Again, that's again the power of the voice of the Lord, the power of creation, that the Lord can do all these things in majesty and meekness all at once. We look at the meanings of these verses and we see the inspiration given to King David to say these words, that the Lord can do so many wonders in the lives of our souls and the life of humanity if we truly seek Him with all our heart. It says in verse 10 and 11, the Lord sat enthroned at the flood and the Lord sits as King forever. Meaning the Lord has been there and has always been. Even when Moses asked, what is your name? He said, I am. He is the great I am. The Lord sat enthroned at the flood. The fathers also look at the flood, not just at Noah's flood, but they look at the flood as in a meaning of the souls that are either seeking God or the souls that are inundated with sins and passions, that the Lord can bring us out of the floods and sins of this passing world onto stability and onto the true place we ought to be, which is on the rock, which is our Lord Jesus Christ. The fathers also say that the flood could represent the points of reference to how a flood is usually a huge thing. So think of the flood of many souls that will come to God being washed in the waters of baptism. So the Lord is enthroned there also. And every one of us ought to say when we pray the Lord's Prayer and say, Thy kingdom come. This is a reminder of this, that we ask the Lord to be enthroned and sit as King in our hearts forever. It says in verse 11, the Lord will give strength to His people. The Lord will bless His people with peace. This is the promises of God, and the Lord delights in blessing us, and blessing us with His strength, and blessing us with His peace. Let us seek Him truly from our heart, that we may enjoy these many graces. And glory be to God forever and ever. Amen.